Okay. All right, so today is June 16th, 2015, and it is my pleasure to be speaking this morning with Bill Blosser. Bill has held numerous roles in connection with Oregon's land use planning system, including a chair of the Land Conservation and Development Commission, the Water Resources Commission, and the Environmental Quality Commission. Bill is often referred to as one of the pioneers of Oregon's wine industry, developing Sokol Blosser vineyards, as well as playing a part in creating the Oregon Wine Growers Association and the Oregon Wine Board. My name is Anthony Lavenda. I'm a Ph.D. candidate here in Urban Studies and Planning, and I'll be speaking with Bill today. Bill, we are honored that you would be willing to sit down with us today. We are hoping to gather as much information as we can from the people who were influential in forming and shaping Oregon's land use system. We are aiming to document the stories, anecdotes, and experiences of people who were involved back then, as well as to get your thoughts on how the system has evolved and where you think it might be headed. We encourage you to share anything you feel is relevant to this effort. So with that, let's begin. As we begin the interview today, I was hoping you could touch on your personal and professional relationship with Oregon's land use system.
Okay. You referred to a little bit in your introduction, but basically for me it started when I got my master's degree in urban planning and came back to Oregon in 1970 and taught for a year in the urban studies program when I was over at Harder House with Danny West, Lynn Husoff, and other people who were there. And that was the period in which some of this, the ideas of Senate Bill 100 were starting to formulate. I only taught here for a year, then I went to work for a consulting firm, CH2M, and so that was about 1971, and then very shortly after that, Senate Bill 100 was passed. And so the whole process of creating land use programs in counties and cities occurred, as well as the development of plans. So I worked on a number of the very first plans that were done, and actually got the second one through DLCD, that was for Dundee, that I was the planner for, a little tiny town out in Yamhill County. But at the same time, under Goal 1, the counties and cities were required to form public participation committees or advisory committees and so forth. So I got on the one in Yamhill County, together with several other vineyard people, because we saw that if there was any hope for preserving agricultural land for vineyards, we needed to influence what happened in that comp plan. And Dave Adelsheim and I created a system of identifying prime vineyard lands in the Willamette Valley. Dave actually, I think, took the biggest hand in that. And we actually created a map, which we then distributed to planning departments all over the valley. And most of them adopted it. So it resulted in the preservation of tens of thousands of acres that were ideal for vineyards. Even though at that time, which is 1972, 73, there were very few acres of vineyards. But because of Goal 3, the ag goal, the counties couldn't just leave a lot of that land zoned residential because it was outside urban growth boundaries, and it was also didn't meet any of the criteria for rural residential at that time. It was still in ag in 20, 40, 100-acre parcels. Mm-hmm. So that made it a relatively easy sell, but still. So that was my initial involvement. And then shortly after we got the comp plan adopted in Yamhill County, I went on the planning commission there and was chair and on that commission for 5 or 6 years. And then there was a pause, and then I went on LCDC, actually appointed by Ficatia, and served there for, my mind's gone. I went on the Water Resources Commission and was on that for 6 years, and then under ATIA. Mm-hmm. And then Goldschmidt asked me to move over to LCDC, and I was there for 9 years. Supposedly, you're only supposed to be on 8 years, but I was on another year because they couldn't get another appointee through the legislature. so I had to stay around. So, a long story, but that's my goal.
That's great. So you referenced Senate Bill 100 in your discussion there, and it created a framework for land use planning across the state, as you mentioned. Based on this legislation, the statewide planning goals were drafted to express the state's policy interest in local land use planning. Do you believe the LCDC, the Land Conservation Development Commission, that was created from this legislation acted correctly to ensure these objectives have been carried out?
I found your choice of the word acted correctly. I just sort of quibble with it, but yeah. That almost asks whether we or other commissions acted legally or those kind of things. The way I would answer is to say that everybody I ever served with took their obligation to implement the legislation very, very seriously. And not everybody that was appointed to the commission necessarily believed with the idea of land use control in the state. But everybody, read the legislation, read the law, and tried to faithfully carry it out. So I guess my answer would be yes, we acted correctly. There are a few instances where courts overturned things that the commission did, not many. And there are numerous cases where the courts, or LUBA, overturned things that counties or cities did. Mm-hmm. But any case, yes, I think we did operate correctly.
Right. So you don't recall any instances where maybe the particular actions weren't aligned with any of the planning statewide planning goals, or where they were in a case where it was particularly was aligned. You mentioned in some of your own work that it passed through because of the ag goal, right?
Right. Well, the commission always had an assistant attorney general that was advising us. And they basically would not let us do something that they thought was illegal,
right.
No matter what we might have had in our mind. So, and I think we always got really good advice from the Justice Department. I see you're interviewing Ann Squire. She is a perfect one to interview because she was on the first commission, mm-hmm. and then became the AG. This kind of gets into the third question about the goals in general. Mm-hmm. The goals cover such a huge swath of possible actions that the commission could take. I remember hearing an outside person, I think it was a speaker from Wisconsin, was here talking about land use. And he said, the amazing thing about the land use program is that basically LCDC could control everything in the state because one goal, one way or another, touches on everything that there is. Now, that's not going to happen, or not really possible. But it does emphasize the fact that goals are extraordinarily broad. So we were constantly in having the question of, is there one goal that's more important than another goal? Or if we adopt something under the ag goal, does it conflict with goal 9 or some other goal? And people who were opposed to what we were doing would often raise that argument that, yeah, okay, you could do this for ag, but you're violating the economic goal because it's defeating the ability of people to make a living or whatever it would be, or the housing goal or something else. So we were constantly having to balance, whether one goal, we were violating a second goal by doing something under one goal. But the AG, I just go back to where I said at the beginning, the AG wouldn't let us do anything that they thought would be illegal. And as you can see from the history, there have been virtually no reversals by courts of what the commission has done.
You referenced some of the question 3, which is relating to the broader set of goals, statewide goals. Which of these goals do you believe have been the most important to the accomplishments of the state land use program, and which ones do you feel have been least important, and why do you think so?
I think when you look at the history of the program and what was the impetus for creating it in the first place, from McCall and that whole history, you see that there were really two or three goals that were really the impetus for trying to do it. Ag being one, housing, rural, all the things to do with rural development, extension of services in the rural areas, and so forth. And then the mere idea of having a comp plan and ordinances that actually meant something. And so those are the core of what was in Hector's mind and the governor's mind when they went to legislature. But then it was broadened to include everything that would be involved in a comprehensive plan. So all the other goals came in. And then later they realized they'd left out all the ones to do with estuaries and the coast, and so those were added on. And none have been added really since then, although there have been discussions of doing that. That's the sort of the history of the program in terms of what it was originally thought was most important. That doesn't mean that that's where necessarily all the rulemaking has happened, but if you were to just take the whole statute then take the OAR that was adopted pursuant to that statute and just add up the pages for under each goal, I think you would see get a very good indication of what LCDC thought was most important to focus on. Because the thickest parts are the ones where the commission and the department spent the most time and where the most questions arose that needed clarification. And the only way to clarify was to adopt a rule. So the ag section early on became very thick because that had the most questions because it was the most land affected in the state. The whole issue about urban areas, urban growth boundaries in particular, no one knew what an urban growth boundary was, and public facilities, housing, all those got very, very attention because they were big questions of, what do we do? Let me back up two and say that one of the most significant changes that the legislature made that had the biggest long-term impact was the creation of LUBA. LUBA didn't exist at the first, when the program was first created. Circuit courts or county courts, I don't know what they were, at a fairly low level of court was making all of the rulings on whether the law was being violated or not. And within a few years, the legislature saw that there was just chaos in the rulings because these local judges just had no experience in land use. Nobody did. And so the rulings were just left and right. They just didn't make any sense. So everything was ending up in the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court because there needed to be some decision. The Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court were already full of work. They didn't want all these little things about a mobile home park or whatever coming up to them. They created LUBA as a special court of specialists in land use. And that just made a huge, huge difference in getting the program, getting consistent rulings on what was legal and what wasn't, that then the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court could deal with in a reasonable way. So I think that, to me, is one of the biggest things, changes that happen. Then we always, people, you ask here down lower, is the public involvement or the goal one turned out to be that important, and what was my experience with it? I mentioned to you I was on a committee in Yamhill County, but it truly is a core of the program and always has been. Mm-hmm. Now, today it's much less in terms of the amount of time that the commission spends or the department, probably minuscule, because the whole process of involving the public in land use process has just become a core native part of every land use program in every county and city in the state. So some counties and cities are more rampant with public involvement and some with a lot less. But nonetheless, the basic core statements in the goal that people shall have a right to be involved, they should get reasonable information, they'll get notice, about all those things that are listed have come to pass, and it's it makes the whole process very accessible to people. Mm-hmm. And that's a major accomplishment, because you don't see that pretty much anywhere else in the country. And in terms of consistently across the whole state. Let me back up and make up one other statement too, is that the whole Oregon land use program is unique in the country. There is no other place where the state is involved to the extent that Oregon is in local land use decisions. There are some, Washington has a kind of a program, and California has some for certain parts of the state, you know, like the coast and ag areas, they have some very strict things. But Oregon is really the only state land use program in the country. So the things, you know, a lot of your questions about is it good or bad or what's the future, I guess I would say we don't really know, because there's no other place to compare it to. You know, we don't, when we've done a lot of the things that we've done, there was no body of knowledge to go and get a book on or call in an expert to ask him, well, how'd you do it in Kansas or Florida or whatever. There just isn't any experience out there. So everything that's happened here has been created out of whole cloth. And so how will it be in the future? I don't know. It has to obviously keep adopting. But you can't look and say, well, maybe the future is what Wisconsin's doing. You know, like you can with a lot of other things, justice and housing and education and so forth. You can look at places around the country and say, wow, New York's really doing well with healthcare, and we ought to try and emulate that. We don't have those things. And then the same with Europe and the rest of the world. We don't have places to look. Mm-hmm. So it's, I think there was a lot of hope, and 1,000 friends had this hope, certainly, that similar programs could be created across the country. But I think the Oregon program created so much terror in around the country that it wasn't possible to even get it considered, really, in any other state. And I guess I would say if the legislature today was asked to adopt it, it probably couldn't adopt it. But the whole public was so outraged over things that were happening at that time, and McCall was so persuasive in the legislature, I think, kind of sort of naively, they didn't realize what they were doing. Not unlike, you know, I don't think the Congress fully understood what they were doing when they adopted EPA. Mm-hmm. Today, it's dealing with climate change that I'm sure Congress didn't think about back then. I'm sure they did. So I'm not sure that the program could have been adopted. I don't think the program could have been adopted again if it were put up. and it's unique in the country, so you can't look at, you know, other places. And so we've created a unique thing that fits Oregon and has evolved and been adapted over time to fit the needs and the personality and politics of Oregon. So other goals are really critical. Sorry to jump around.
Please.
Some goals, I would call them were sleeper goals until some big problem came up. And I think one of the best examples is Goal 12, transportation. That was just kind of in there, and you had to do a transportation element in your plan, and they were, it was probably 3 pages long or something. That was all was in the rules. And then some giant issues came up with ODOT, and mainly with ODOT being blocked in doing projects because of the land use program, because they couldn't meet various issues under urbanization goal, and particularly urbanization goal. And so major projects, Western Bypass was the biggest one at that time, were just, they were going around in circles spending tens of thousands of dollars and they couldn't get anywhere. So Washington County, as well as ODOT, and 1,000 friends at that time, they were frustrated because they thought ODOT was this maniac little loose element going out there building freeways everywhere. And in the past, they did build a lot of freeways. But the House of Representatives wanted to put a stop to that because of the opening of rural areas to. So between the House of Friends and ODOT, they came to the LCDC and said, we need a rule that tells us what to do. We don't know what transportation planning is. And you're not telling us, there's this vague stuff in the goal. So that created the transportation planning goal, plus all of the things that have happened, court cases and everything since then. But it was an attempt to respond to a need, which was, clarify, please, what do you mean by transportation planning, so that we can do it. And ODOT, you know, they did, you know, there were old timers who wanted to build freeways, but the leadership at that time was more of a mind of saying, just tell us what to do, and we'll do it. So some of that same stuff came in the ag goal. It was fairly, very simple at first, and then over time it got thicker and thicker and thicker as more questions arose that needed answering. And so one general thing I would say about LCDC and the department is that a lot of what you see in the OAR, the rules, was the result of specific problems arising that counties or cities, state agencies, they didn't know what to do. And the logical, since so much of it had to do with development or land use or something that affected land use, like highways or extending public services out to subdivisions or how much housing, you know, urban growth boundaries, how much land you needed and so forth. A lot of the rulemaking arose because we were trying to answer people's questions. You know, what do you mean by this or that? So often, if you look at the early goals, there'd be just a few nice sounding words that then became very controversial. Well, what do they mean? You know, what's a farm home? What's a legitimate farm home? And so all those questions eventually came to the commission for answering. And the commission is still doing this, still trying to answer questions about what did you mean? What does this nice goal mean? Now, there hasn't been much rulemaking around many of the areas because they haven't really caused those kinds of questions. There hasn't been much around natural hazards. I'm just looking here at recreation, energy, not much. The greenway, not much. Estuaries, shorelands, all those. There's not a lot of rulemaking because there haven't been a lot of questions. There's a little bit, but not a lot. But there's been a lot of questions. Goal 5, what's a comp plan? Etc. There's a considerable room. And also the commission and department looked a lot at court cases. So if there was a court case that or a bunch of court cases around a certain issue, then that would give an impetus to the department to maybe we better adopt a rule so that everybody isn't spending time in court. So, one other thing, I'm expanding these first questions into a much bigger thing, but one of the, I think, biggest accomplishments of the program is that as much as people complain about state control and LCDC and all this, I think there have been a number of studies across the country that show that the certainty of approval of a application for a home or a development in Oregon is much higher than in any other state in the country because there are comp plans that do mean something. Mm-hmm. So if it says this is commercial, then it's very difficult for a city to, almost impossible for a city to deny commercial on that piece of property, which is not true in a lot of other states, particularly in states that have this, the layer on top of their land use program of NEPA or the State Environmental Policy Acts, which put you through a whole EIS process and open a whole different avenue for people to bring in a lot of issues that tie you up forever and often defeat people even going ahead with a project if they think they're going to have to do an EIS. In California is that situation, Washington is that situation. So, you know, Oregon's got a lot of benefit out of having predictability, near certainty that if it's zoned for multifamily housing, you can build multifamily housing. And by the same token, the process for changing a plan is much more open and much more subject to review because of the public involvement segment of it. Commissioners can't just, because they have a friend who wants to build a high-rise someplace, they can't just quickly change something, as you see around the rest of the country. And the process is slow with that, you know, for changing things, but there's a high degree of certainty. So, you know, it means that if there's an urban growth boundary and it says that you can build housing inside there, you can build housing. And it's not true in the rest of the country. So that's a major accomplishment, I think. And it's also one of the reasons that we never adopted a NEPA type process in the state. It was proposed a number of times because everybody else seemed to be doing it, not everybody, but many other states. And the argument was always, well, we basically already have that. The land use program basically requires the comp plan to think of all these issues before they designate something for housing. Mm-hmm. They have to think of wetlands, they got to think of this and that and the other thing. So it never got the impetus in the legislature to adopt it. Okay, so now let me ask you, ask a question.
Great. No, it's great. I had one question from an earlier comment you made about LUBA, or mm-hmm. Land Use Board of Appeals. Saying that it was kind of a really great way to not bring cases to the Supreme Court. And I was wondering if you remember any particular cases that really incited or were like leading to the establishment of LUBA. You said there was a lot of contestation.
I don't. That we'd have to inquire somebody in the Justice Department would have to, I don't recall any mm-hmm. specifics. I'm trying to remember which one. I mean, are you interviewing he was the director of Thousand Friends for a number of years, and I think he lives out of state now.
Henry Richmond?
No, not Henry. Well, anyway, he used to come to the commission meeting almost every year and give us a little present wrapped up in paper. And the present would be about, you've succeeded one more year of not answering the question. And it came out of a case in Coosa County, and I can't even remember the name of the case anymore. It's all gone fuzzy. But it was a LUBA case mm-hmm. that was so complicated in terms of deciding what was a legitimate rural residential, or, you know, this issue of rural development. And we picked away at it with a number of little rules, but we never answered the big question. I think even to this day, it hasn't been mm-hmm. that the issues raised in that case have never been answered. So whether that was one that, I think that was I'm pretty sure that was a LUBA case, so. I can't answer your question.
Oh, no, it's okay. Totally fine. I was just wondering if there was like a particular moment you really remembered where it's like, oh, we really need to establish another court to deal with this issue. That's all I was thinking. You know,
I just think that my recollection is it just became messy so quickly.
Yeah.
And I think the local judges around the state were happy to have it happen because they didn't know what to do with these things. Mm-hmm. They were used to handling, you know, domestic issues and traffic issues and, you know, civil cases, mm-hmm. of the garden variety civil cases.
Right.
The land use stuff was crazy. And there was no precedent at that time either. So they were creating the precedent, and so in a letter it was kind of all over the place.
Yeah.
Anyway.
OK. Okay, so are there any land use policies, subjects, or topics that you think are missing that the LCDC should have addressed in these, in the goals?
Well, I think that when you go through the goals, you'll find that just about every subject you could think of is covered. Although I don't know that in the energy goal or any natural resources goal or any of them, the word climate change appears. I'm pretty sure it doesn't, because nobody would have thought of it back then. But I would bet that you could construe it in the words that are in several goals if the department wanted to get into climate change. Other than that, every goal touches on basically every topic that's out there in terms of the life of people around the state. Now, like I said at the right beginning, a number of the goals are not developed. I mean, the department hasn't done very much with them. So like the energy goal, hadn't done much at all. Kind of left that to the energy department to do whatever they're gonna do. Or other, you know, building codes people or whatever. And natural hazards, there's some, but not a whole lot. Kind of left that to Dugami to do. So there are a number of goals that if issues became even bigger, the department could get into, because the goal is sitting there and there's room to develop something. But the short answer to your thing is no, I think the department has, there aren't any really big gatekeeping holes that I see.
So in 1974, as you know, the LCDC and DLCD undertook an unprecedented public outreach and involvement effort, as you mentioned earlier, in adopting the first 14 goals. And was this worth doing? How, if at all, did it affect your thinking and views at the time?
Okay, well, I think I answered that already, so I'm not going to just repeat it, but it was critical and was important for my own experience in doing it in Yamhill County and when I was on the side of being in one of those committees, and then watching it, sitting on the commission, watching the amount of testimony we had on issues, and we'd had packed rooms on some issues, and everybody who wanted to talk had a chance to talk. And that's still the case, and it's important.
I was wondering also if you could sort of reflect on your experience in the Yamhill County Planning Commission, and also maybe your thoughts about LCDC outside and then inside LCDC, and reflect on some of the experiences with LCDC being both in the Yamhill County and then actually acting as a director on the inside. Especially in relation to maybe goal one or some of the other goals.
The ironies is that at the time that the first comp plans were adopted, Yamhill County was regarded as one of the leaders, visionaries in terms of planning in the state. And then shortly after, I don't know, somewhere in the early or mid-80s, the politics in the county completely switched, and the county commissioners were some of the most anti-land use in the state, as well as some of the legislators that went to were elected. And so Yamhill County, when I got onto the LCDC, was one of the counties that we had the most lawsuits against from the state level, because they were, from our point of view, rampantly violating the law. And I believe we won every case against Yamhill County. Thousand Friends brought a lot of those actions. And there were a couple other counties that were the noted ones that were fighting the land use program. And Yamhill County became one of them. So I had the experience of being on the other side. Of seeing them trying to systematically undermine what had originally been adopted in the county. So that was sad, but it was what it was. I think you know, you're talking to Art Schlack and to some county people, and you'll get their perspective. But when I look at the, I use the word battles, or the places that the department and the commission had the most arguments with local government, was I would say 80% of them were with counties, and I think it was because counties saw their mission as being having a certain mission that completely was contrary to what the goals were trying to do, particularly around preservation of ag land and the spreading of urbanization out into the counties. And virtually all the battles were over that issue. It wasn't over housing or transportation or any of these other things. It was over rural development and how much housing, rural residential, should be allowed outside of incorporated cities. Mm-hmm. And the cities, the counties saw their mission as letting anybody build a house where they wanted to. And the program, particularly with the constant litigation from 1,000 Friends, was the contrary to that. So that's where, if you look at all the court cases, or particularly in the first 20 years, I'll bet you, I don't know, I'm just guessing, 90% of them have to do with rural land issues. The amount of issues with cities was pretty minimal. Cities saw themselves as trying to accommodate housing and do all these things. There were issues with cities over Goal 5, how much land needed to be set aside for natural areas, there were issues over housing, because there were the exclusionary zoning issues came up, and there were some number of lawsuits against cities who wanted to ban mobile home parks or multifamily dwellings, that we had to tell them no, you have to allow all kinds of housing. But the amount of arguments with cities was minimal compared to the arguments with counties. Mm-hmm. So I saw that, you know, having come from a county that was, you know, pushing for preservation of ag land, I understood their perspective, I understood what they were trying to do, but I spent 9 years fighting with counties, and Yamhill County was one of them.
So this sort of leads into the next question, I think. Have the statewide planning goals struck a balance between state and local control that LCDC intended in 1974?
Well, the word balance is interesting. Mm-hmm. The legislature, in adopting Senate Bill 100, intended to shift the balance, which was 100% local at that time, to the state having a say in what happened at the local level. So once the legislature made that decision, that radically shifted the balance question right from day one, because the balance was 100% one way before, and now it was where? 50-50? Mm-hmm. 40-60? That's been the question ever since, is where is the correct balance point? And when you look at the legislation, clear, as I said at the very beginning, the huge motivation of the legislature adopting it was over rural land preservation, preventing rampant subdivisions out of rural land, mm-hmm. and preserving ag, particularly in the Willamette Valley. So the balance shifted radically with that legislation. And so my short answer is, yeah, I think LCDC has struck the right balance, but it has been a battle ever since. I mean, there have been 4 or 5 statewide ballot measures, either modifying what LCDC can or should do, or trying to wipe it out entirely. Mm-hmm. I mean, just there were, by the time I got on the commission, there had already been, I think, 2 statewide ballot measures to get rid of it entirely, mm-hmm. that failed. But not by a huge amount. I mean, they failed, but it wasn't like 60-40, it was like 53 or 54 to 47 or something. I mean, it wasn't by a whole lot. It didn't get just wiped out. The baby didn't get killed in the cradle. My answer is yeah. I think we've stuck by the thing. As to there isn't, the legislature didn't say here is the balance point. It just threw this piece of legislation, which wasn't very long, and then the department created these goals, which also, or the commission, don't strike a balance. They don't say that ag is more important than urban or the. There's nowhere in there that says this goal is more important than that goal. Mm-hmm. So there's this constant balancing question that comes up all the time. And my, you know, I'm biased obviously, but I think, yeah, we did strike a good balance. And we see a lot of evidence of really good things having happened because of it. But that will be a debate forever. And I think the whole thing over where there was a statewide referendum on a lot of record or people who this takings issue of I can't remember the measure number anywhere, 49, whatever it was, that for 5 or 6 years required the department to rule on whether somebody had a pre-existing right to have, you know, an expectation and a pre-existing right to be able to put houses out on their rural land. Mm-hmm. And there were a number of those approved. But then there was another legislation initiative that rolled back a lot of it. Mm-hmm. And so you can see that the state, in its own mind, is not 100% in favor of everything the LCDC does. I mean, it's a touch and go thing in terms of the votes. Mm-hmm. But in the end, it's the key votes have been keep it. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, thank you. So in what ways have prominent state and local elected officials, ballot measures, actions by the Oregon legislature, and key court rulings advanced or undercut the original purposes of Senate Bill 100 and the drafting and implementation of the state planning goals?
Well, I think we've touched on that, quite a bit of that already, yeah. But Well, the first part of it, you know, state and local elected officials. As I said, there's been a contention between the counties and LCDC from day one. And so that has been a ongoing contentious issue. Not so much for the cities. There has been, that would answer that part of the question. Ballot measures, we already talked about those. Couple that were trying to wipe out the program entirely, and others that were trying to handle this problem of people's rights to have homes on rural lands. So those have been big issues, or I mean big impacts. Legislature, there is I don't think you could find one legislative session since 1972 where there hasn't been an amendment to the statute. Mm-hmm. Every session, the legislature has often myriad proposals. In the years that I was on the commission, one of the key pieces of legislation that always came up was the budget. And the way that the anti-land use people saw their lever for the program was to defund the department as much as they could. And so every session that was about. And usually the DLCD budget was one of the last ones to get adopted because it was the sort of bargaining chip that was held to the end. And so it was always about. We always knew. But the other aspect of it is that virtually every session, the legislature made some change. One during when I was there was the whole secondary lands thing that they created to basically allow more rural residential in what we call secondary lands, or less, or you could translate that as less important ag lands. That was trying to relieve this pressure the counties were feeling and allow them a little more room to allow rural residential out in less valuable land. So that's where the word high value land, ag land, was created, and definitions of that and so forth. So if you look at the amendments that have actually been passed in the legislature, again, I would say 70-80% more affect the ag goal. Mm-hmm. They're all around what's permitted in ag lands. And there is a huge list of things that are permitted. You know, they put in this thing for dog kennels, and there's all kinds of little amendments, tweaks, where somebody wanted to do something and they came to the legislature and they got it approved. So there's now the list of what's permitted in ag is really quite long. It hasn't overall totally undermined the ag goal by any means, because most of them are small tweaks, but every session has been. And in the last two or three sessions, there's been a bunch of changes for wineries with respect around the issue of tasting rooms. Mm-hmm. It wasn't an issue early on, and so wineries are just permitted. But then the traffic created by tasting rooms, and then wineries wanting to have events and weddings, and suddenly it became a question whether they're really a winery and, you know, what's going on. So legislature's dealt with that in the last two or three sessions, trying to clarify that. So there's been a lot of legislative action. Courts, I mean, there's a huge body of court decisions. And I'm not a lawyer, I can't really comment on that, but there's a lot of other people you're interviewing, I can tell you. But there's a ton of things that the courts have done. And to clarify things, and that's their role. So I don't know, and you asked, you have here, did they advance or undercut the original purposes? Mm-hmm. Again, the purposes of Senate Bill 100 are pretty broad, so did they undercut them? Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think legislatures, if you asked the legislators, they would say, no, we're not undercutting, we're just improving, we're just, you know, molding. And I think as a commissioner, and I would say the same thing, we were trying to implement it, so advance it, yes, we were trying to advance what we thought its intent was. But sometimes the courts said our intent were wrong, and sometimes the legislature said, no, you guys got that wrong, we don't want you to do that. And so the legislature changed something. So whenever, you know, when I was on the commission, whenever a legislator would come and testify that you guys are violating the law, I would say, We're just implementing the law as we see it written, and as the Attorney General tells us it is. If we're wrong, just, you're the legislator, just change it in the legislature. Just change it. You have the ultimate power. All we're here is just administrators. And sometimes that's what they would do. They would change the law. That's their job. Mm-hmm. So.
You mentioned a little bit about decisions in the most recent sessions of the legislature around wineries. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if you could reflect on your own involvement in Oregon's wine industry and its relations with land use planning, and just some of your own personal experiences.
Yeah. Well, going back to that map that Dave Adelsheim and I did back in 73 or somewhere around there, I can't remember how many acres we created a formula, which was basically land above a certain elevation in the valley, and no higher than a certain elevation, or we thought it got too cold, and slopes that were not no steeper than a certain amount, exposures from east to west, no north exposures. So we created kind of a formula. And I don't remember the number of acres total that we came up with, but I remember we thought at that time that if we could preserve 10,000 acres, it would be the most that could ever possibly be for humans in the Lavenda Valley. That was just, you know, at that point there were probably 150 or 200 acres maybe grapes. The last statistics I saw, there was like 12,000 acres in grapes in the Lavenda Valley, which doesn't even touch on the amount of acres that have that are potential. But we've already passed it. And so from a vineyard point of view, the biggest single thing that happened was that decision, the impelled by the ag rule, to rezone tens of thousands of acres in the Lavenda Valley from rural residential to ag. It made it possible for the industry to exist. Because if we had been fighting with subdivisions out in these hills, we just wouldn't have happened, because they would always pay, undoubtedly pay more than we could pay. But also the conflicts with people who have their house there and they don't want the dust or the spraying or the noise. Or when we were applying for our license to have a winery, we had a good citizen involvement thing was going on. huge number of neighbors came out to protest us having a winery. And when you parsed the testimony, most of it was around the vineyards. They didn't like the noise of the cannons that we used to scare birds. They didn't like the migrant workers, because they were going to rape and pillage, and the kids weren't safe to be outside playing. And so it was really related to the vineyards that they were attacking the winery. We got approved, but there, if that initial preservation hadn't occurred, we wouldn't have even had a chance to even apply for a winery. But there's just a lot of fear around it, and there was. And so if we'd had a lot more houses dotted around, there would have been just even more of that. Mm-hmm. And ag in general, there have been surveys done of that around the valley over the years. And the biggest single problem that farmers have is people out living out close to them that are not really farmers and that don't like the noise or whatever, or their kids. You know, one problem we had for a number of years was kids out, you know, vandalizing irrigation systems or pumps, and we had some issues with kids that weren't farm kids, you know, running their motor scooters through the vineyard and breaking vines and stuff. There is a conflict between rural residential and any kind of ag. And so it would have really hurt our industry, as it does help hurt any other ag, all the rest of ag. So I you know, I'm extraordinarily proud of what's happened with the industry. I mean, whoever thought, I mean, nobody thought this could happen. It's to the point, it's sort of ironic. I was approaching Yamhill County, there. The road planning committee, they have a citizen committee, about designating a new, I call it the wine trail, of a little rural road that would wind through the Dundee Hills. And, you know, it would allow people to access to a lot more vineyards and wineries if you were to pave it and make a, you know, sign it and so on. And the basic answer was, you wineries, you've got everything you need already. We've taken care of you. Now we gotta take care of other people. I mean, that wasn't literally what they said, but that was the gist of it. Was, you know, if you guys want it, you pay for it. Just, you know, you guys have lots of money. You can just pave your own roads. But so that's actually an accomplishment to where they think that we're doing so well. We don't need any more help. I guess that's, it's helped Oregon on the map in a lot of ways. And mm-hmm. just, you know, the high tech industry has, timber always has, of course, the beaches and the mountains. But the winery industry's added a whole new aspect of tourism and a significant industry. It's well over $1 billion now. Anyway.
Thank you. Switching gears a little bit, how do you think Oregon's land use program in 2015 today compares with what it was envisioned 4 decades ago?
Well, you know, just like I would give the same answer as I would in terms of the wine industry. You know, mm-hmm. we had no idea what the wine industry would develop as. We didn't have a vision that it could, and probably even in our wildest dreams, we didn't envision it would be like it is today. And I think the same with the land use program. I don't think anybody had a clear vision of what. There's nobody who could have said how central it would be to everything that happens in the state. Mm-hmm. It was just an idea that was adopted in a very short piece of legislation. And then once the goals were adopted, people said, oh, this is a little more than we thought. And then each step, as new goals have been amended or new rules have been adopted, it's got richer and more complete. I don't think anybody envisioned. Mm-hmm. It was a very incremental thing, and it's still incremental. I mean, mm-hmm. who knows what it'll be 20 or 30 years from now. But it certainly seems to be pretty well locked into the fabric of law and society and everything in the state. And so I don't think it's just going to go away. I mean, somebody would have to replace it, obviously. Because even those who are the most opposed to the land use program, I think there are parts of it that they would fight to keep from a state perspective on. Mm-hmm. Some of the natural resources things, the ag thing, the transportation, people would want there to be some coherence to the transportation system. So, I don't know, it's just more, there'll be more incremental evolution than mm-hmm. I hate to even try to envision 15 years from now. Mm-hmm.
So how about your own like personal thought, like how you felt about it when you first interacted with the land use planning system, or maybe some of your first feelings? Or...
Well, you know, I was an urban planner, so I thought it was marvelous.
Yeah.
I thought it was, it was a cutting edge of anything that had been done in the United States. Mm-hmm. No one else was trying it. And people were, you know, in planning school, we were talking about it, but it had never been done. So here I end up in Oregon, and it happens. And so I was in hog heaven, you know, mm-hmm. from a planner's point of view. Now if you ask Art Schlack, he probably said it was been his nightmare his whole life.
Was there anything in particular that made it feel like hog heaven? As a planner, I mean, it seems like, yeah, it's a really unique system, but was it just like the feeling that you got as a planner felt like you were able to do more because of the statewide system, or what was it?
Well, yeah, you got to actually debate the issues that were just theoretical ones at planning school about how do you balance these issues between rural and urban. How do you look at the issue from a statewide point of view and not just a pure local issue, mm-hmm. where every little town and village and county is doing their own thing that has no that may be when you add it all up harmful to the state as a whole. So it was just a wonderful opportunity to try to rationally look at these bigger issues and ask the question, what's good for the state? And then what is legitimate local stuff that we don't need to worry about? Let them take care of it. And by and large, if you look at the planning requirements for cities, mostly the cities can kind of do what they want. And there are clearly guidelines that they have to do, but and they're the ones, as I said, that have had the most trouble with the program. But from a planner's point of view, it was wonderful to be able to, you know, just help set some reasonable, broad guidelines so that one city wasn't screwing all the poor people by saying, we're not going to have any low-income housing, period. We're sort of enforcing a social value of the state of, we've all got to accept some of the low-income people. And things like that, just then I felt good that we were trying to create an ethic that applied to everybody and didn't just apply to me because I'm wealthier or... the transportation issue is one of... It's very easy to be short-sighted about transportation, and particularly about state highways. And there was a lot of people, the impetus in communities was put all the traffic on the state highway because it's their highway and they'll maintain it and they'll bring money. And we won't build any local roads. So you have all these towns where their main drag is the state highway. And the first few years that may have been pretty nice, but after a short while it completely choked the town and killed the town. So Yandale County, Dundee, Newburgh have been just killed by state highway right through the middle of town. The transportation rule helped try to rebalance that and force cities to build some of your own roads and create the town center and be a town, don't just be a stop on a highway. Most of the rest of the country there's no pushback from the state to keep everybody from being strip commercial on Iowa. We haven't done perfectly, but there's been a lot of good things in trying to again rebalance this thing about what's truly local and what is a state interest for the people as a whole. And so was from a planner, as a planner, that was wonderful to be able to be in those arguments and to have a potential of adopting something that would be statewide. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you. So are there any changes or additions you'd like to see in our planning laws and in the statewide goals to enable Oregon's land use program to face challenges of the future?
I thought about that a lot, and I didn't even write a note down. I can't really think of something at this point. I think, as I said, it's a very evolutionary thing, and I think if you were to talk to the current chair of the commission, you'd get a much better perspective on what the issues are they see coming up that they need to deal with. I've been away from them for a while, and I don't... all I know is that within the goals, there is the incubus is there to tackle any issue that might come up, with the possible exception of global warming. But I think that even that one could be handled. So do I have specific things? I don't have any specific things that I think they need to deal with. But I'm sure 1,000 Friends or the current chair would. Mm-hmm. One good thoughtful person. You have your list and you're probably be happy to get through that. You're not trying to add any more people, but John Van Landingham, who was the chair for quite a while, is a very thoughtful guy, and he's way more recent than I am. He would be just worth asking that question of. And you do have Henry Richmond over there.
Lord Dennis.
And Robert Liberty, that's the guy I was trying to think of. Robert is the one who would bring us the package. Is he today? Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. No.
He's here at PSU.
Yeah, right. But are you going to interview him?
Yeah.
Or is he, because
yeah,
he's a... Yeah. Yeah, Robert will tell you stories about how he used to bring us a gift and we'd unwrap it. It was like, congratulations, you delayed one more year to deal with this problem.
Okay, so do you have any other thoughts, anecdotes, or experiences you'd like to share with us while we have you?
No, I think I remember over the years, the appointees to the commission, some would come on who were pretty anti-land use, and over their terms, they evolved, and some who were rapidly pro-land use, everybody evolved more to a centrist thing and saw the problems of being extremes either way. And some of our people who were toughest in the end, toughest on agriculture, were in ag and came on a commission, you know, ready to straighten out those LCDs that you're being too tough on rural lands. So over the years, I've served with a lot of really very thoughtful commissioners. And over time, everybody got educated in what was possible, what wasn't, and what was really a core thing that was important to the state versus what could just be left to local people to deal with. So, that's all.
Hey, well, thank you very much for your time today. It was a pleasure to meet you, and I'm sure everyone will enjoy the recording. Yeah.
Probably no one will ever see any of these unless they're writing.